Hello, and welcome to the next video in the Electrical Overstress on ADC TI Precision Lab series. In this video, we will examine how to protect data converters with back-to-back internal Zener ESD diodes as well as SCR-type ESD protection diodes. This type of protection scheme is useful when the input voltage range is wider than the supply voltage range of the ADC. For this ESD protection structure, we will use external TVS diodes and current limiting resistors. In addition to showing how to select the values for the protection components, we will also take a look at their impact on performance. This slide shows an analog front-end with an internal back-to-back Zener diode type input protection clamp. Before taking a closer look at this clamp, let's discuss why a simple ESD diode will not work for this device. Notice that this device has an input voltage range of plus minus 10 volts, but the analog supply is only 5 volts. In the case of an ESD diode, it is connected between the input and the power supply so that the input voltage is always clamped to the power supply voltage plus a diode drop. If an ESD diode was used for this device, the input voltage would be clamped to 5.3 volts. So, clearly, we need a different type of clamp when the input voltage swings beyond the power supply rails. This is why a back-to-back Zener diode structure is used. You can see from the IV curve on the left that across the plus minus 10 volt linear input range, the clamp is not active in a high impedance state. In the case of an overstress signal, the clamp will turn on just above positive 15 volts and just below negative 15 volts. Take note that this is a typical curve and the actual clamp voltage will vary from device to device. Looking at the absolute maximum ratings, you can see that the maximum input voltage range is plus minus 15 volts, and the maximum input current range is plus minus 10 milliamps. It is important to note that the internal clamp alone does not limit the input signal to be below the absolute maximum voltage rating, so as a best practice, it is recommended to use an external clamp that limits the signal to be less than 15 volts during fault conditions as well. Nevertheless, a common approach for protection is to simply limit the input current and rely on the internal clamp to limit the voltage. Let's take a quick look at that on the next slide. This circuit employs an external current limiting resistor to limit the current when a fault condition occurs. In this example, a 40-volt peak-to-peak sinusoidal overstress signal is applied, so the voltage across the external resistor is 40 volts minus the 15-volt clamp voltage. Dividing by the 10 milliamp absolute maximum input current shows that the minimum series limiting resistor value is 2.5 kiloohms. To add some design margin, a larger resistor of 3 kiloohms is selected. The results for this configuration were measured with an oscilloscope on the analog input pin, and the scope waveform shows that the input of the data converter is limited to be about plus minus 18 volts. As mentioned before, this is slightly outside the maximum limits, but for transient overstress events, this is an effective method for protecting the device. On the other hand, this method is not recommended for situations where the clamp could be turned on for extended periods of time, as this can degrade the performance and reliability of the device. Later we will show an external clamp circuit that can be used for continuous EOS faults. Before moving on though, let's take a look at the measured performance of the circuit. This slide shows that the measured performance of the ADS8588S is not impacted by the external 3 kiloohm current limiting resistor. In this measurement, the ADC is running at the full sampling rate and the measured performance is very close to the typical performance. On the next slide, we will see how using a larger current limiting resistor can impact performance. This slide shows a figure from the ADS8588S datasheet that demonstrates how THD is degraded by adding an external series resistance to the input. The reason that this series resistance impacts the performance is that it interacts with the nonlinear input capacitance and therefore distorts the input signal. This nonlinearity is caused by the capacitor's large voltage coefficient. As you would expect, as the input resistance increases, the input current decreases, which protects the device from electrical overstress. On the previous slides, we looked at the ADS8588S, which is an example of a data converter with an analog front end that has an internal back-to-back Zener diode clamp. A similar device, the ADS8688, also has an integrated analog front end, but uses an internal SCR-type ESD protection circuit to protect the inputs. The SER type ESD protection is only intended for out-of-circuit protection of the device. This means that the ESD protection protects the device during manufacturing, test, and assembly when it is not powered up. This type of input protection cannot be used to protect the device during normal operation as it will remain active once triggered. The only way to turn off this type of protection is to cycle the power on the device. As an example, if a short duration EOS pulse is applied to the input, the SCR protection circuit will trigger and effectively short the inputs to ground. The SCR protection will remain in this state until the device's power is cycled, and if the device is left in a powered state with the SCR protection in a triggered state, the device will likely have permanent, irreversible damage. For this reason, it is not possible to protect devices with SCR type input protection using the simple current limiting resistor that is sometimes used with the Zener input clamp devices. Next, we will look at an external clamp circuit that can be used to protect an ADC with SCR-based input protection. This slide shows a scheme that uses an external bidirectional TVS diode and a series current limiting resistor, shown as RP. This type of protection can be used for both back-to-back Zener and SCR type input protection. The key point here is that the external voltage is clamped to a level that prevents the internal clamp from turning on. For example, if a 40 volt overstress signal is applied to the input and an external bidirectional TVS diode is used, the input will be clamped to 12 volts and 28 volts will be dropped across the current limiting resistor, RP. The purpose of RP is to make sure that the current into the TVS diode is not too high. During an overstress event, no current flows through RFILT or into the internal protection clamps. In the next section, we will take a closer look at how to choose the best TVS diode based on its specifications and how to choose the external resistors and capacitors. First, as a reminder, we will review the specifications of the bidirectional TVS diode. The bidirectional TVS diode is really just two back-to-back unidirectional TVS diodes connected so that they have the equal positive and negative breakdowns. First, the reverse breakdown voltage, VR, is the voltage range that the device can operate and still guarantee low leakage. The characteristic curve on the right shows that the reverse standoff voltage range is the maximum linear input voltage range for the device. If the signal goes beyond the reverse standoff voltage range, the leakage will increase and the TVS diode will eventually break down. To protect the input of the ADC, the TVS diode breakdown voltage should never be lower than the absolute maximum ratings for the ADC. For example, if the absolute maximum rating of the ADC is plus minus 15 volts, the breakdown voltage should be a lower voltage such as plus minus 12 volts. To protect the input of the ADC, the TVS diode breakdown voltage should be lower than the absolute maximum rating of the ADC. This slide shows an example of selecting a TVS diode to protect the ADS8588S. First, notice that the ADS8588S normal input signal range is plus minus 10 volts, so we should find a TVS diode that has a minimum reverse standoff voltage of 10 volts. Next, notice that the ADS8588S absolute maximum input voltage is plus minus 15 volts, so the maximum breakdown voltage should be below 15 volts. The SMC-J10CA meets both of these criteria, so this is a suitable TVS protection device. Other specifications to consider are the leakage current, peak power dissipation, and the reverse capacitance. The leakage current will translate into an offset voltage when it passes through the protection resistor. Power dissipation is the most important specification if a large transient current can flow through the TVS diode. Since our design has a series current limiting resistor, this is unlikely. Although capacitance is not shown in the table, it can usually be found as a graph in the TVS diode datasheet. From a distortion performance perspective, it is important to minimize this capacitance. We will look at this in detail on the next few slides. On this slide, we will select a series current limiting resistor for the SMC-J10CA TVS diode and the ADS8588S design that we looked at a few slides ago. The objective of the resistor is to limit the current into the TVS diode so that the power dissipation of the external resistor and the TVS diode are bounded. One key point to understand is that the peak power dissipation is the power dissipation that the device can withstand for 1 millisecond, whereas the steady state power dissipation is for a continuous DC signal. We will design our circuit for a continuous 40-volt DC fault input voltage. First, let's choose a resistor that will limit the fault current so that the resistor's maximum power dissipation is less than 1 watt. This happens when the maximum voltage is across the resistor, which is calculated by taking the maximum input voltage minus the minimum voltage across the TVS diode. Using this voltage squared over power produces the minimum protection resistor value of 835 ohms for RP. For design margin, we round the resistor value up from 835 ohms to 1 kiloohms. Using this resistor value, we can calculate the maximum current during a fault, which is 29 milliamps in this case. Finally, we can calculate the power dissipated in the TVS diode using the maximum current and maximum voltage across the TVS, VC. Note that this is a very conservative approach and the actual voltage across the TVS should be much less than VC because the current through it is low compared to the max current. The calculated maximum TVS power is 491 milliwatts for this example, which is significantly less than the 5 watt steady state power rating. So, for this example, the resistor dissipates approximately 1 watt and the TVS dissipates about half a watt during a fault. This power dissipation is fairly high and will require a power resistor. You may choose to use a larger series resistor to minimize the required power ratings. However, as we will soon see, the size of the series resistor has a large impact on the overall performance. Before checking the performance, we need to choose values for R-filt and C-filt. In general, with this kind of protection, the ADC internal protection clamp should remain off because the breakdown voltage on the external TVS is much lower than the internal clamp breakdown voltage. For this example, the worst case breakdown voltage on the external TVS diode is about 12.3 volts, whereas the internal clamp turns on between 15 and 16 volts. However, if a very large transient fault is applied to the input, it is possible for extremely large currents to flow through the TVS diode. This large transient current can increase the voltage across the TVS to a point where the internal clamp may turn on. In this case, it is important to make sure that the resistor R-filt can limit the ADC input current to be less than 10 milliamps. Looking at the numbers on the left, you can see that the absolute maximum input voltage for the ADC is plus minus 15 volts and the maximum input current is plus minus 10 milliamps. For the TVS diode, it will have a maximum voltage of 17 volts when 88.3 amps is flowing through it. Note that this large peak current can only flow for a brief period of time, but during this time it is possible for the internal input clamps to turn on. Assuming the maximum voltage on the TVS is 17 volts and the internal clamp turns on at 15 volts, you can calculate the minimum resistor value for R-filt to be at least 200 ohms. In this case, it is rounded up to 1 kiloohm. The capacitor C-filt is normally selected to be 1 nanofarad as this is the standard input capacitance to minimize the impact of RFI pickup on the input. The value of R-filt can be adjusted to choose different input cutoff frequencies. Now that we have selected all the components, let's check the circuit's performance. This slide shows the measured FFT and AC performance specifications for our example circuit. Notice the large harmonics near the fundamental. Also notice the measured THD is negative 69.6 dB, whereas the typical THD expected for the data converter is negative 110 dB. These measurements were all done at the full sampling rate with a 1 kHz input signal. The external components for this protection example significantly degraded the distortion performance of the system. On the next slide, we will explore the fundamental reasons for this distortion. The main reason that the input signal can become distorted when using the TVS type input protection is the fact that the TVS diode has a reverse capacitance with a large voltage coefficient. This means that as the input signal voltage changes, the capacitance across the TVS diode will also change. The input protection resistance, RP, and the reverse capacitance of the TVS diode will form a low-pass filter. The attenuation of this input filter changes according to the input voltage because the diode capacitance changes according to the input signal. So, the attenuation at the peak of the signal is different than the attenuation near 0 volts. This distorts the shape of the signal and degrades the THD performance. Knowing that the capacitance of the TVS diode has a strong impact on distortion, let's compare the measured results for multiple TVS diodes with different capacitance specifications. This table compares three different diodes with three different capacitance levels. The first is the device that we used in the previous example. This is a very commonly used TVS device with a capacitance ranging from 2.3 nanofarads to 10 nanofarads. When using this device, the ADC has a THD of negative 69.6 dB, which is substantially worse than the negative 110 dB typical specification for the ADS8588S. The other two devices show that performance improves as capacitance decreases. That concludes this video. Thank you for watching. Please try the quiz to check your understanding of this video's content. Question 1. For the circuit below, what is the power dissipated in RP for a continuous 53-volt overstress input voltage? The correct answer is C, 0.8 watts. Subtracting the 13-volt drop from the 53-volt input signal gives 40 volts across the 2 kilo-ohm resistor. 40 volts squared divided by 2 kilo-ohms results in 0.8 watts. Question 2. True/False. A current-limiting resistor can be used as input protection in devices with an internal back-to-back Zener ESD cell. The correct answer is A, true. For devices with an internal back-to-back Zener, a simple series resistor provides basic protection. In cases where continuous or multiple repeated faults can occur, an additional external Zener is recommended. Question 3, true/False. A current-limiting resistor can be used as input protection in devices with an internal SCR-type ESD cell. The correct answer is B, false. For SCR type input protection, you never want this protection to trigger when power is applied. Thus, for this type of internal ESD input protection, you should always use an external TVS diode to avoid triggering the internal SCR. Question 4. What is the main performance limitation caused by using a series resistor with a TVS diode? The correct answer is A. The nonlinear diode capacitance and series resistance create distortion. The capacitance on a TVS diode has a large voltage coefficient. When this capacitance interacts with the input resistance, it creates a filter with a cutoff frequency that changes based on the input amplitude. This effectively distorts the input signal. Question 5. True/False. A low capacitance TVS diode can be used to reduce THD. The correct answer is A, true. In the presentation, we compare THD performance with a low and high capacitance TVS diode. The low capacitance TVS diode gives better THD performance, but may not have a high power rating. Question 6. A plus minus 12 volt input range should be protected with what kind of TVS diode? The correct answer is C, bidirectional with standoff equal to 12 volts. Since the signal is both positive and negative, a bidirectional diode is needed. The standoff voltage is the usable input range, so the standoff voltage should be set to 12 volts or higher.